Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu. This is Rami Nsour, and this is part of the MCC nightly Ramadan reminders during Ramadan 2020. We hope that you and your families are doing well, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept your fasts and accept your ibadah. In the last couple of videos, I was talking about ring structure or ring composition in the Qur'an, and how it's important for us to try to uncover new things in the Qur'an, not rulings, theological or practice-wise, because those have already been done. We already know the rules that are derived from the Qur'an. We already know the aqidah, the theology that's derived from the Qur'an. But to find new pearls, and I'll use that example because there was during the early Mufassirun period, the people who were explaining the Qur'an, there were certain things in the Qur'an that they didn't quite understand, and I'll give you an example. One of them is mentioned in Surah Al-Hadid, in the chapter of iron. And Allah explains or describes how He brought iron. وَأَنزَلْنَا الْحَدِيدَ. We have sent down. وَأَنزَلْنَا الْحَدِيدَ. Now, for the early Muslims who were looking at this, they said, "Well, what does this mean? This means, you know, أَنزَلْنَا means sent down. Well, we find the iron in the ground." So they had to look at it linguistically and say, "Oh, there's another way that the Arabic language can use this word, which means avharna, we have brought forth, we have brought out." And so that's what's happening. Now we know through modern astronomy, and not even so modern, it's been known for a while, that the iron's coming down in the meteorites. So we can look at it with its original intent. Another example, using the pearl example, in Surah Ar-Rahman, everything's mentioned in pairs. And Allah says about the pearls, about the fresh water and the salt water, يُخْرَجُ مِنْهُمَا اللُّؤْلُؤُ وَالْمَرْجَانِ, that He takes out of both of them, لُؤْلُؤ and مَرْجَانِ, the pearls and coral. And so the early scholars, they didn't know about freshwater pearls, so they said, "Oh, this is تغريب لأحد الجانبين," that sometimes you can use the dual to refer to just one aspect of it. Like in Arabic, you say al-qamaran, the two moons, when you mean the moon and the sun. Or al-umaran, the two umaras, mean Umar and Abu Bakr. So you can use one to refer to two. But then one time, and there's a story actually, where a person got a freshwater pearl, and he went into a court of scholars or a gathering of scholars, and he said, "I bear witness that this pearl is from fresh water. So that ayah, we can consider it to be on its original state. So we're going to be looking for these pearls in the Quran. And that's what one of the things that I feel about the patterns of the ring patterns, that we can look at it and we can try to find what are some of the patterns that we find here. So in the previous two lectures, I discussed Surah Al-Baqarah and some of the ring patterns and ring composition that's present there. And then in the second video was Surah Yusuf and some of the ring patterns there. What I want to do with this video is look at the entire Quran. And we have to remember that the Quran was not revealed in the order that we have it right now. It was revealed, there's a chronological sequence of how it was revealed. And in next week's video, I'm going to talk a little bit about that. But now that we look at all of the ayahs as they are in the Mus'haf, can we find a ring pattern there? Can we find some patterns where, as I mentioned, it starts at one theme and then moves down, and then there's a central theme? And the author of this book that I'm looking at, it's called Structure and Quranic Interpretation, he says the meaning is in the middle. Like, look for that middle meaning, and then it works backwards as well. So can we apply this to the entire Quran, starting at the beginning, working down, and then working back? And why this is also amazing is that when we find this pattern, we have to remember that it was revealed, the Quran was revealed over 23 years. And it was coming in different parts, and different parts of surahs were revealed in different areas. But now when it's all put together in this final form, we see this pattern. So we can refute some of those people who say that the Prophet ﷺ wrote this on his own. Because how would he have done this? How would he have maintained this structure in something that was being revealed over 23 years? But when it was finally put together, it has this pattern. So if we look at the first few verses, the first few chapters, chapter 2 through 5, which is Surah Al-Baqarah, Ali Imran, and Nisa and Al-Ma'idah. And these four were Medinan period surahs, which have a lot of laws. But the begin one of the themes that we find there is in Surah Al-Baqarah about monotheism and the throne verse, Ayat al-Kursi, which I also describe the ring structure that is in there. The corresponding at the other end of the Qur'an is Surah Al-Ikhlas. So we find that. The beginning, it's talking about monotheism, and then we have Ikhlas. In Surah Ali Imran, there's a discussion about Badr and how the believers were victorious over the disbelievers. Now we go over to its corresponding or approximate corresponding surah at the end of the Qur'an, and it's Surah Al-Lahab. So the damnation of Abu Lahab, who died immediately after Badr. So there's a connection there between Badr, mentioned there at the front, Surah Ali Imran, and Badr, something related to Badr. And then in Surah Al-Ma'idah, there's a recollection of a time where the disbelievers prevented the believers from going into Mecca. And then if we look at its corresponding verse at the end, we find crowds entering God's religion and the farewell pilgrimage. إِذَا جَاءَ نَصْرُ اللَّهِ وَالْفَتْحِ. So at the beginning, it says that when they were prevented from doing the Hajj, and then it talks about the Fatih, and at the end. Then we go on to Surah Al-An'am, livestock. It's corresponding at the end, Surah Al-Kawthar, the abundance. So the idea of livestock and abundance. In Surah At-Tawbah, believers are the new custodians of the Kaaba. We go over to its corresponding at the end of the Quran by sequence, Quraysh, who are called to who are the former custodians of the Kaaba. So in Surah At-Tawbah, the believers are the custodians of the Kaaba. At the end, in Surah Quraysh, the Quraysh, who are the former custodians of the Kaaba, are called to worship Allah. And then it goes on. So what's amazing, and I don't have time to go through everything, but you can see some of these similarities as it goes from the beginning and it's corresponding from the end. I'll take another one. Surah Al-Furqan, chapter 25. If we look at what it approximately corresponds to the end using this kind of triangle structure, the Surah Al-Furqan, chapter 25, corresponds to chapter 86, that talks about the Quran separates the truth from the falsehood. There is also in chapter 32, Surah As-Sajda. Of course, the whole surah is about sajda. If we look at its corresponding at the end of the Quran, when the Quran is recited to disbelievers, they do not bow and worship. Subhanallah. Look at these correlations. Okay, so if we do this and we see this structure, well, then what's in the middle? We got surahs 50 to 56, which are right there in the middle. It goes up. And what do we have in surah 50 to 56? Right before that? The last few surahs, 47 to 49, and then 57 to 66. Those surahs, what kind of brings them together at that tail end? Surah to Muhammad, the surah of Muhammad, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And it is corresponding in 61, Ahmed, the story of Isa alayhi salam saying, I will bring a prophet named Ahmed. And then it goes on. But when I was looking at this, I thought to myself, subhanAllah, if we're looking for the heart of the meaning of the Quran, and it's taking all of these ideas and it comes down to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, to him, the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And another thing as well that it comes down to, which is doing tasbih and glorifying your Lord. So basically it comes down to La ilaha illallah, praise and recognition and glorifying Allah, and then the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So if we really want to get close to the Quran, we have to get close to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He is the heart of the Quran. He is the one who guides us to the Quran. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to guide us during this month and for the rest of our lives to be closer to the Quran, to be closer to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, to get us that much closer to the Quran and to Allah, and to bring us closer to him on Yawm al-Qiyamah. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah.